What are you getting after? What seeds are you planting? What are you overcoming? Think big. Think even bigger. Take some risks. God's got your back. Go for it. Don't hold back. Don't ever have regrets in your life. Go fail. Go grow from those things. Live your life.
Your identity is not defined by your successes or your failures.
If you're not happy where you're at, you won't be happy where you're going. Choose to do the things that will make you the person you want to be, that will make you a better person next week and next year.
You're going to have to leave some things you're actually good at behind so that you can find what you're wired for, what you're born for.
Being a world-class entrepreneur is being in every area of life excellent.
It is the little things that are so easy not to do.
The best thing that you can do is assume the best in people.
I want people around the world to believe they can do something great with their life.
If I build the biggest business, but I destroy my physical body and I lose my health, I don't think that's success. While you're on the journey climbing to success, never forget the things that matter most.
If you like this episode, be sure to hit the subscribe button. What's going on? It's your friend Jonathan Frederick from the Heart Healthy Hustle Show. It's Monday, September 16th, 2019, and I'm stoked that you're with us today. We're going to be doing a solo episode today. Incredible interviews recently, and stay tuned. If you are a podcaster looking for tips on starting a top-ranked podcast, I'm going to share with you at the end of this episode tactical tips that you can use. If you're a podcaster, you're going to get a lot of value from that. I can guarantee it. Or if you're starting a podcast. Before we get into this episode, please share this show with at least one friend by the end of today. Since putting the intentional message in the outro of the podcast, this is simply a solo episode about how my life has changed and what I learned from interviewing people for over a year of life. I have done a bit of a review at episode 100. This is very specific lessons. Before I do, I want to go ahead and recommend to you guys a couple fun things that I use to stay on the top of my game physically each and every day. One thing is noise-canceling headphones. I'm not sponsored or affiliated with anyone, but I recommend a good pair of noise-canceling headphones, especially if you travel much. They are very nice to decrease that pressure and noise of loud, hectic environments. It's hard to find solitude, but do your best to find it at least once a week, whether it's a walk in the woods, get alone and quiet for a good 20 minutes to 2 hours every single week. It's a game changer. Another thing, filtered water. Drink at least your doctor's recommendations, but I'm drinking at least a gallon a day and it's filtered water. So what's amazing is the more you start drinking, it's known as awakening your thirst. And it may sound corny, it may sound foolish to you, but municipal water, nothing wrong with it. I'm grateful to have clean water. Don't get me wrong. However, there is some stuff wrong with it. In fact, there's trace drugs that are, I forget the chemical terminology, but I believe that there are still trace amounts of certain drugs in our municipal supply because it's you can't break it down with the system that they use to purify the water. I recommend Berkey filters. Honestly, the best tasting water I've ever had. They don't add anything to the water, but once it's filtered through all the filters, the water tastes sweet. It tastes good. Intake of water, increase that intake. It's so helpful. Moving into today's episode, if you want to check out those water filters, it's Berkey. What I learned from interviewing people for 1 year of my life. One, everything I do now is intentional. Everything I do is intentional. I have whiteboards all over. I plan. I have a big calendar on the wall. I have a small planner on my desk. I have a calendar app for my scheduling interviews. I make the most of every moment that I can. If I go on a conference trip, business conference, I'm very intentional about learning about the people to my left and to my right. Shout out to everybody who's listening to this right now who I met. If we met in Ohio, Columbus, Ohio at the Summit of Greatness 2 weeks ago, shout out to you. Much love. I really am grateful that we met. I think of so many names right now of just wonderful people who are generous and kind and want to see everyone around them do very well. So shout out to you and keep going. I'm very humbled to have met you. Number two. Interviewing people for over a year on a consistent basis humbled me by showing me, without a shadow of a doubt, I have a lot to learn. This is something that is hard for a lot of young 20-somethings who really want that validation to prove themselves. Look what I can do. I can do it. That kid in all of us at one point in our lives kind of needs that validation to say, hey, you're like, you know what? You actually don't need validation. You have what it takes. Just take a breath. Keep moving forward. You're killing the game. Good job. But you don't need that. When you interview so many different people from different backgrounds and different businesses, different entrepreneurs and different fields, I learned the more I learn, the less I know. Being curious and reading and interviewing and being curious and analytical and questioning and growing, you realize there's less and less of what you thought you understood. There's less and less stuff that you know. When I interview people, you just learn over time. It's like this accruing of realization, if that makes sense. For other podcasters who do interviews, you may understand where I'm getting at with this. It's this feeling and this realization that we really don't know very much. And the more you learn that there's the less you know. It's very much something that I've been realizing. Lesson number three, posturing is immature and actually makes you look dumb, worse, and not better, especially to a guest. When I say posturing, I define that as gloating or boasting for the sake of trying to impress other people. You can share facts. I've done this. I've shared on interviews like, oh yeah, I've had that person on the show while I'm interviewing someone just to spark rapport versus saying it to flex or to say, oh yeah, check out these guests I've had. It's just something to keep in mind, especially in your life. Posturing is very immature and it actually makes you look like a dummy because it doesn't work. Nobody's impressed by it. True winners, and I'm not saying that if you don't realize this, you aren't a winner. But I am saying true winners can see right through posturing and they aren't impressed by it. It's actually a huge red flag, a huge turnoff. For example, I think posturing is more when you're in conversation. It's a focus on yourself, trying to come across well to others versus trying to learn about others and trying to be present there and caring about others and learning about them. This is a huge key, something that I've learned over the last year and a half that I desire to master. I desire to master the art of curiosity. Posturing aside, okay, this is something else that stems from that as a tangent. I grew up with a lot of people who would ask me questions, right? So you just naturally think, oh, I must be really interesting, or oh, people must care about what's going on in my life. And, you know, then I moved away from where I grew up and, you know, I got less and less of that. People still are curious and want to know and ask you questions wherever you go, but it was less. And so I recognized that, okay, hey, just because the setting or environment I grew up in, people were asking me questions most of the time, that's actually not a great way for me to learn how to ask other people questions and be curious about them. Also recognize that you don't have to share anything about yourself if the person you are speaking with or the people you're speaking with don't ask you reciprocal questions. Take note of that as well, because if you're in conversation, you think you're having a great conversation, you're learning all about them, or if they're asking you all the questions and have you talking and talking and talking, acknowledge and appreciate and answer succinctly, but additionally, you want to be present. You want to say, okay, well, what about you? Share a bit about yourself. I want to know about this with your life. I'm curious. I'm very curious, and I would love to learn more about you, I'd like to learn more about you. Just be honest. It matters. It matters. Just because somebody asks you a ton of questions doesn't actually mean that they are interested in hearing the answers, especially the drawn out answers. Keep that in mind. People will talk with you for a long time. I'm learning to be on the other side of that where I may ask some questions and if the person I'm speaking with doesn't think to ask any questions in return, it's not to their detriment, but it does show a bit of narcissism. I mean, I think we all are guilty of it at times, but especially myself, I've been in the past where just because somebody asked me a bunch of questions, I kind of fail to even ask any reciprocal questions, any at all. Like you may think that, oh, what a great conversation. I really like them. And then you realize I didn't learn anything about them. So be curious, be interested in others, and don't posture. This has been perhaps the best side effect of starting a podcast and starting this personal brand and all of this stuff. It has been, you create a platform for yourself. It's very freeing. You have options and connections. And here's what I mean by this. You may work full time. Awesome. You may own a business and do that only full time. Awesome. You may do both. When you start something for yourself, you choose yourself. It is the most freeing, perhaps, feeling, economically speaking, because you are free. Nobody has veto power over your life. And I did an episode a long time ago, months ago, where I think I actually spoke on that veto power over your life, because that is a source of stress for many of us, which is, oh, well, my employer has complete control over my well-being. I think it's great to work full-time, and I enjoy it. The point of what I'm saying here is when you choose yourself, you choose to do something on the side or as your priority, but it's not taking anything away from your full-time capacities, you get a sense of freedom. You feel like you're really living your purpose. You're going after it. You're enjoying yourself. And then two, you realize that you're not tied down and you're not stuck anywhere ever for anything. Like, you could move across the country if you had to, or if you wanted to. You could go on that trip you wanted to go on, and you have more flexibility, and not only in your schedule, but in your mind, because you recognize that, okay, hey, like, for example, I'll give you a very, very clear example. My podcast, I've interviewed over 80 people at this point. I could call any single one of those people, minus maybe like two or three, and almost every single one of them would either be cool with me interviewing for a position with their company or with them, or would be more than happy to forward my information, my resume, to somebody that they know. And most of the people I've interviewed are connected with decent power players in almost every field. So if I wanted to get into almost any business, I could reach out to this list of people who I've interviewed. Do you know how amazing that feels? I'm not saying this to brag at all. That would be the dumbest thing. My point is, when you do something for yourself and you choose to go for it, despite the judgment, despite the initial scowls, despite all of that, you are so rewarded because you just kept pressing on, you were consistent, and guess what? A year later, 2 years later, you are more free than all of your connections because you have connections with so many people. You've provided value to them. You're always looking out for them. When that happens, it is such a good feeling. And that has been perhaps the biggest career advancement, if you will, or just freedom that I can't express it enough. It's something that I want every single one of you guys to do if you're not already. I know a lot of you, if not most of you, are. When you can say in the back of your mind, I just spoke with somebody about this and it was such a great connection, such a good conversation, and I feel so happy that I'm doing this. No one's telling me to do it. I don't have to do it. I'm doing it by choice. And now I'm connected with these people in a positive way. You create so much just joy. I don't know, a contentment. Next, go and live where you feel inspired. It matters. Environment is key. So if I was living in a poor environment in any way, you will be influenced and maybe not completely derailed or crashed. But if you're not in a good environment where you can feel comfortable to do your thing, to get your work done, then you're not going to thrive to the max of your capabilities. You're just not. Here's the deal. I've moved multiple times. Since starting this podcast, I moved once due to environment. At the end of the day, your environment needs to be almost an incubator. I am recommending, be aware. If you've got something good going on, not everyone's happy about that. And most people don't know how to rejoice with you if you do have something like that going on. It's not, they may have no problem with you at all, but guess what? Are they happy for you? Don't expect it. So what I'm saying is, make sure if you're living in an environment where, like, I was speaking to a good friend of mine a couple weeks ago in Ohio. We were talking about his roommate situation, and he said, look, I've known this guy since sixth grade. He's like my best friend, but it's really holding me down, holding me back. He's so negative. Every time I get home from work, this, that, and the third, instead of having good, uplifting conversations, I'm just having these negative, hey, you want to play some video games? And then that's about it. And I'm like, dude, you need to move. When's the date you're going to move by? He said by November. So he agreed. That matters. Your environment will affect your output. It will affect the quality of your work. But for now, I just want to remind you, if you are in an environment that is not ideal or helping you to progress, or it's robbing you of momentum because your room is always a mess, it can start with something as simple as making your bed, cleaning your room. My layout of my current bedroom to be incredibly efficient, but also like a very warm and grounding environment. I put a plan in there. Two have since died, but that's okay. I put a plant in there and it's dead, but you know, the point is I laid it out so it's clean, it's neat. I know where things are when I need them, and it keeps me grounded. Like when I go in there, I'm like, I can take a breath of fresh air and just relax into the environment versus feeling completely stressed out, completely under pressure, completely like, oh my goodness. That brings me, this kind of plays off of my last point, which was the choosing yourself and creating something for yourself in terms of business or a project that you throw your heart and soul into. Entrepreneurial personality types need healthy environments. We need momentum conducive environments. And when we don't have that, we can get so down and so hard on ourselves. We may feel like, well, what's the problem? What am I doing wrong? Is my sleep schedule messed up? Am I just a failure? Like what is going on? Many times it can have a lot to do, and does typically have a lot to do with environment. It may have nothing to do with you. So don't be too hard on yourself. Be honest and assess your environment and get out. If you're in a bad environment, find something better, spend more money. You are worth the investment. Brings me to my next point. The best investment you can make is one, yes, in yourself, but number one, in others. You know, in terms of financial investments, the number one investment financially that you can make for economical advancement is yourself, investing in yourself. So what I mean by this, be okay with spending money on yourself to get a massage if you feel uptight all the time. Be okay with buying a little bit healthier groceries, maybe getting a membership to a wholesale club that's got organic food that you can buy for cheaper. Time will pass anyway, regardless of if you do these now or if you tell yourself, oh, I'll do that 5-10 years when I'm loaded. Start taking more intention in these areas. Invest in yourself, not just for physical health, but in every aspect. Investing in yourself is so important. Investing in knowledge, investing money, straight up paying money for helpful courses, for helpful coaching, for helpful conferences, for helpful group that you could be a part of, where, you know, a group of business owners. You know, you don't want to be a sucker and just give your money to everyone, especially online. However, there are wise investments that you can make. For example, I spent over $1,000 to go on this trip. When you consider the ticket, you consider the time spent planning for it, the plane tickets, room and board, the food, all of that, it was well over $1,000. The lifts, a bunch of Lyft rides, like, you know, Uber and Lyft, bunch of Lyft rides, all of that added up to over $1,200 just for this one trip for 4 days, you know, 4.5 days. And you may say, wow, that is such a big chunk of money. I don't have just $1,200 sitting around. Neither do I, to spend like that. But here's the deal. When you commit in advance that you are going to do things like this at least once a year, the price doesn't really matter. I could have, in fairness, if I had been on my game, I could have cut the living hotel cost down by more than half. I could have had more preparation in the category of food. Trip like that, where you're out of town for 4 or 5 days in another state at a conference. Be willing to make those investments in yourself, especially now, especially for the singles out there. If you're listening to this and you're single, now is the time to make those investments, because you're not going to want to be doing that when you have kids. If you do have kids, you can still do it. However, it becomes a lot harder. There's not a nursery at these conferences where you can just drop your kid off with some strangers for the day. Yeah, do these things while you're single. The singles out there, now is the time. Now is the time. Be investing in yourself. There can be a little too much investing in yourself if you're not careful. So what I said, investing in others, when you're on this investing in yourself, when you're spending money on yourself to improve and to grow and to take adventures, even adventures, right? Doing things that light you up, that are recreational, that these are all very important, because they're important for our brains, physically, even speaking, and spiritually, everything. It matters so much. But in terms of financially putting down hard cash that investment right now, even if you're not anywhere near where you need or want to be financially, is in yourself. I believe that 100%. Now, I'm not talking about tithing, giving, or anything like that. That's completely separate. After all that's done, and you've been generous with the initial money that you've been blessed with to steward, now I believe the next best investment, that's what I'm speaking on, is the investment side of things. You need to invest in yourself. Because here's the deal, right? Look at it like this. Let's say you invest in stocks or bonds. You put all your money into that, or an allocation of your money, a small percentage. If you didn't invest in yourself first to learn about that and how to do that, or go to the right people, or get in the right rooms, go to the right charity events to connect with the right people, to talk about these topics before you put your money into those investments. That's why a lot of people don't get anywhere with their quote unquote investment portfolio, whether that's stocks, whether that's real estate, whether that's businesses. So many people just think if I make an quote unquote investment, then they're going to have an ROI. That's not the case. A lot of times those things go bust. And the reason is, and it's my strong belief, that it's usually due to a lack of education, planning, and investing in themselves first. So when you say, oh, well, I don't have a ton of money right now, or the money I do have is being used for all this other stuff, also prioritize, make it a tab in your balance statement that you are going to invest in yourself a certain amount of money every single year, and budget it out, because it matters. Another investment that's not financial is the time investment into yourself, into personal growth, into your relationship with God. All that stuff is so important. Again, I think it needs to come first and foremost, because if your bucket isn't full, your cup's not full, you're not going to be able to pour into other people how you need to. As generous giving people, it's important that we stay on top of that stuff. All right, so if you're still listening, cheers to you. We're almost wrapped up with the lessons that I've really learned over the last year of interviewing so many people. For over a year and a half, what I've been learning. Now, one of the last things I have on here is you can connect with virtually anyone. Just be consistent. And as a matter of fact, you can connect with anyone. Anyone. I really mean that. It's a fact. You can connect with anyone, and in a much more personal way than you may expect that is possible. You know, when I started this podcast, I had no clue that I'd be sitting in the same rooms as some of the people that I've been in the room with. I additionally didn't expect that I would be so quickly able to interview people who have millions of followers and who have billions of views on YouTube and have huge companies making hundreds of millions of dollars each year. I have been able to, and a lot of that is because of consistency. You can connect with anyone. You really can. If you have questions for them, you can connect with anyone. One of the TV shows that I loved in college was called The Buried Life. It was all about, what do you want to do before you die? What do you want to do before you die? What would happen is many of the people would say, oh, I really want to connect with my adopted son who I haven't seen in 25 years or something like that, right? And then they'd find the family members and they would connect or whatever. So it really is quite incredible. We are going to wrap up this episode with some tips for other podcasters. Let's get into them. Prepare for interviews, do your homework, listen to other interviews that they've done, watch their content, learn their story, know who they are as much as you can before each interview. The more homework you do, the better interview you will have. When you aren't prepared for an interview, it's awkward, it's uncomfortable. The guest can typically tell if you read their book or not, or books plural, and it just makes for, it may be a fine interview, because they're probably used to it. But think about the alternative. If you had read their book, you had taken notes, you looked into their website thoroughly, you have a unique intro ready for them, not just the bio on their website, you have you've watched a couple of their interviews that they've done. You have specific questions for them specifically ready to rock. That interview is going to be so much richer than one where you are simply going off your template and your last minute. Because trust me, I've done both, and more than of the latter than I like to admit. I did a really good job of doing homework initially when I started this show. Now, with so many guests coming on, it's been definitely more of a challenge, but something I still do. I will watch probably the quickest and easiest hack, if you will, to learning about your guest who's about to come onto your show is to watch interviews that they've done in the past. I'm not saying that if you don't do your homework, you can't have a great interview, but I am saying you're much more likely to enjoy yourself and be calm and poised and have a killer interview when you are prepared. Because when you're prepared, you're armed. You have comments and things you can insert into the conversation 10, 20 minutes in that shows your guest that you respect them so much that you've done all this homework, you know about them, their story. You kind of have a lot of things you can use to egg the conversation on if there's ever a dull moment. And that is really a huge factor for having a successful interview. I've had very few dull, awkward moments, honestly, almost ever. And the reason is because of preparation. And touching back on this again, you, as a podcaster, it's remarkable, but there is still enough of the podcast nuance of, whoa, podcasting, the new hot thing of audio with all these Alexa and Google Home and all this stuff, Siri, all this stuff is still fresh and new enough to where people are genuinely. But a lot of people are still seeing podcasts as something new and hip and exciting. It's something that even somebody who's an incredibly established scientist or author or speaker, whatever the case may be, if they don't know exactly what podcasting is or how it works, all they know is that it's kind of like a digital radio show. To that person who doesn't know how to leverage technology yet, podcasting is a great opportunity. And I'm not saying to only focus on people like that, but recognize that you have a lot to offer. You have a platform to offer to them that they are not used to being on or leveraging. So it's something that, you know, brings me to my last point, and that is know your worth. If you're a podcaster, know your worth, especially if you put your heart and soul into your show, you have a quality show, and that doesn't mean don't always be looking to improve. Always, of course, be looking to improve. But know your worth. I still, to this day, when I talk about my show, I downplay it. I don't. For the other podcasters out there, know your worth. Talk your show up. Make sure you believe in it 110%. If somebody asks you about it, know how to explain it in 6 words or less. I'm going to be honest with you. Let you in on a secret. Until last week, I didn't really have a 6-word explanation for my show. Now I explain it like this. I host a podcast called The Heart Healthy Hustle Show that's about how to go all out without burning out. If you want to have a conversation about any of this with me, email me. It's Jonathan@theheartheathyhustle.com. If you're interested in being on the show or you know somebody who would be an excellent fit for this podcast, email bookings, plural, bookings at triplehpodcast.com. So that's hhhpodcast.com. Bookings at hhhpodcast.com. We'll get back with you. Appreciate all the listening. If you're a podcaster, always be looking to improve and adapt, and don't be romantic about your initial, oh, this is what it's all about. Be willing to change it if it's necessary. If you're not getting the response you really, really know that you're trying to make, the impact you're trying to make, it's not happening, be willing to adapt, be willing to change. So always remember, live wide open and Godspeed. Thank you for listening. Have a great week. I will see you next Monday. Excited. I'm excited, guys. We got some incredible guests coming on the show. I just spoke Friday night. I interviewed the founder, okay, this is going to blow your mind, the founder of Spartan Races, the founder. It was my Friday night spent talking to him, an Italian born and raised in New York, I believe, near North Jersey. We had a great conversation. You know, we talked about the mafia. We talked about the mafia. We talked about health. We talked about business. We talked about family. We talked about all this stuff. So it's really an incredible time for the Heart Healthy Hustle Show. There's only more yet to come. And you guys are the reason for that. So thank you. Have a great day. Live wide open and Godspeed. Congratulations on making it to the end of this episode. What about this episode stood out to you? Next, I need your help sharing this show. I want this podcast to impact and reach 6,000 people per episode by August 31st, 2019. And I want us to reach 15,000 people per month by March 29th, 2020. Have you been enjoying multiple episodes of the Heart Healthy Hustle? I'm thrilled to share with you an exclusive invitation to join our new Facebook community. To get to know other Heart Healthy Hustlers, simply go to theheartheathyhustle.com/Facebook, where you can expect to see different members of our community being featured weekly in Facebook Live calls. I appreciate all of your love and support, and I will see you in the next episode. As always, be generous on every occasion. There is a story for you, and live wide open. Yeah.